Hey, everybody. Audio. Hey, I don't have audio.
You don't?
There we go. There we go. Hey. Hi, everybody. Welcome to another episode of Star Citizen Happy Hour. I'm your host, Community Manager Jared Huckaby. We're doing things a little differently today. We have a panel. We have a panel of guests. We have a plethora of guests here today in all four of our boxes here. Immediately to my right, and I don't know what box you're in, you are, Vinny, why don't you introduce yourself?
I'm Vince Sinatra. I'm the QA manager here in LA.
How you doing, Vinny?
I'm hanging in there. How about yourself?
Good. Thank you for joining us today on Happy Hour.
Yeah, no problem.
Our good friend Tyler Wicken, community manager out of the Austin office, is a little under the weather, so Vinny has offered to fill in for us here. So thank you so much, Vinny, for playing. I feel good about you carrying me today.
Yeah, no, victory. My back's going to be hurting by the end of the day, but you know. We'll be all right.
All right. Also, in the hot seat, as far as our guest, we have a double dose of guests with us today. We have Director of Community Engagement, Online Strategy, and Spaceships, Mr. Ben Lesnick. How you doing, Ben?
Hi, everybody. I'm doing great.
With a triumphant return to live streaming. I'm so happy you're here, man.
I'm happy to be here.
Yep. And then, of course, we have Elwin Bachiller, Jr., star of the next great starship. Yeah, I keep bringing that up. How you doing, Elwin?
I'm doing good.
What's your title here in the studio today?
I'm lead vehicle artist in LA.
Lead vehicle artist in LA. So we have three people quite intricately involved in our ship process. We have Ben, who is the director of spaceships here. We have Elwin, who leads the spaceship building team here in the LA office, and Vinny here, who you know. Spearheads the QA of the ships, mm-hmm. And if you spend any time in our shipyard forums, you've probably seen a number of threads created by Vinny here, getting all that feedback for ship performance and stuff. So yeah, so in today's show, you're probably gonna want to focus your questions on ships because that's what we're gonna be able to talk about here. So what are we gonna play today, guys? I was thinking since we have a ship focus here, and since I would like to. Oh, I'm sorry. I forgot one more. I forgot the most important person on our show today. Joining us all the way from the Netherlands. He's not sitting here. I'm looking down the list, and I'm like, I feel like there's somebody missing. I thought we had five people on the show, and I forgot he was coming over. He's coming over all the way from the Netherlands.
That's
Sergeant
toddler
Gamble.
Logic, Jared. That's if I can't see them, he must not be here.
Nobody has ever looked at me and said, that guy has object permanence.
I was about to walk away.
Sergeant Gamble, how you doing, man?
Pretty good, man. Thank you for asking. How about yourselves?
I'm doing very well. So you're joining us from the Netherlands today, huh?
Yes. Yes, yes. That's the second European guy that you have on the show?
Yeah. We had our first show was Meyer from the UK, and then we had a Bristol boy last week. So
right.
We're just working our way around the globe at this point. So
cool.
So you are a streamer. Why don't you tell folks a little, before we get started, why don't you tell folks a little bit about your stream?
Yeah, I'm a streamer. I broadcast live on Twitch, and I am what you can call a streamer that is dedicated to the game Star Citizen. We do play a lot of variety as well. But Star Citizen is like 80% of our focus. So, yeah.
All right.
That's about it.
And a lot of streamers are in stream groups. What stream group are you in?
I'm in a stream group called Test Gaming.
Never heard of them.
Well, it's actually it's kind of a spin-off what Test Squadron is. I mean, Test Squadron is the organization, and Test Gaming actually involved to a stream team that is actually looking outside of the community of Star Citizen as well. So we grew a little bit, but yes, we are still very much connected to Test.
Yes, I noticed the Test emotes dropping into chat now as we speak. Oh, and Meyer's here. Hi, Meyer. All right, so we are going to get started today as far as gameplay, playing a little Pirates Swarm, because last time we tried it, the team beat it, but I didn't make it to the final round. So it's a personal thing. I want to try to make it here. So we are going to do that. Ben, why don't you tell us a little bit about what's going on in Star Citizen today?
That's a very broad question.
Yeah, well, I'm waiting for the questions to come in. So, guys, you have Elwin Bachiller Jr., who works on the shipbuilding team. You've got Ben Lesnick, Director of Ships and Community Engagement. And you've got Vinny here. So go ahead and send your questions into Twitch chat here. Remember to preface your question with the word question in capital letters and brackets. It helps me picked them out. Right off the bat, we have a question for Vince, Elwin, and Ben. Have you ever sat next to a Mountie before?
That would be no, but I have been to Canada a few times.
that's a question for Sergeant Gamble there. Let's see, right off the bat.
I'm never going to lose that again, am I?
Probably not, probably
that's
not.
That's going to stick with me for the rest of my life, probably.
Let's see, what else? Oh, Elwin, right off the bat, we can talk about what you're working on, Lee. What are you working on right now?
Right now, I'm actually redoing the Aurora. It's a little weird hearing myself on this, so
you're not used it'll to take a minute. Voice?
No, not while I'm speaking, having it blasted in my own ears. So I'm actually updating the Aurora. So essentially what I'm doing is taking the design that we currently have and updating it with the technology that we have on all of our newer ships. So custom normals, we'll have the new damage setup. So the Aurora will end up being a lot more optimized, and it'll run a lot better. And it'll also accommodate a lot of our ship item technology that we need.
All right.
So this really is a test themed stream. We've got the Aurora. We've got...
All right. We'll keep Gamble, why don't you go ahead and ready up for our game here. And
sure.
I think I have a little visual aid here. Let's see if I can make a little visual aid happen here. This is Elwin's current work on the Aurora. Now, this is obviously not finished.
I took this morning, basically. It's the exact current state of the Aurora. I haven't gotten to the interior yet, so essentially what you're looking at is mostly just the exterior of the ship having been essentially remodeled, and I still have to do a couple of tweaks, but I'm moving on to the phase where now I start to apply my textures, set up all the materials, add palms, and just make the exterior all look really beautiful.
This does look really nice. Now, this coloring, obviously, this isn't the final coloring. This is just...
No, so the Aurora has a lot of skins.
Yes, it does. Right? Yes, it does.
And so our skin system has gone through several evolutions. So initially, the Aurora that's in the game now has several skins using an older version of the way we essentially create our skins. And as a result, I have to sort of try and interpret the older skin to the way we are going to be moving forward with doing different color combinations. So what you're looking at now is essentially the base Aurora and the way I'm kind of interpreting it a little bit. Mm-hmm. You'll notice that at the wingtips you have some raw metal bits exposed.
Yeah.
The original Aurora has that across the entire ship, which I think is a little bit too strong to have that across the entire thing. That's more of a MISC ship style, mm-hmm. where they have the aluminum raw metal, you know, exposed on the entire thing. RSI doesn't quite do that. So I'm going to keep some of the raw metal in there on the wings just for flavor, but the rest of it will fall more in line with the new constellation.
All right.
That's quite a responsibility. I mean, this is, you know, all the people will argue forever what the best ship is or what their favorite ship is, but there's no question that the Aurora is the most numerous ship. So it's
that is true. Yeah.
Oh yeah. For an overwhelming majority of our players, I mean, the Aurora will be their first experience with Star Citizen. So that's a very important ship.
Yeah, you're doing a good job.
Thank you. Well, I definitely feel the pressure, I have to say. There's a lot going on with that ship. I redid the animations for the landing gears and the ladder and all that. So we're essentially rebuilding it. I mean, it's not just like a quick little update. It's taking quite a bit of time.
And this update will, of course, apply to all the Aurora variants.
Yes. So in addition to just doing, you know, the base Aurora, that means I'd have to go through and redo all of the parts for every variant as well.
And one thing we always get after we talk about a ship update, this is going to update existing Auroras. Now, it's not a new Aurora that you have to buy separately.
Yeah. Right, exactly. So this isn't like next year's version of the Aurora, right? It's not a brand new one. It's just it's going to replace all the existing ones.
Now, the Aurora LN was a slight hull variant back when it was introduced. I believe it had the additional fin, the additional intakes out the side.
Right, yeah. So that specifically, intakes obviously are still part of our ships. But in the Aurora, what we're going to do is the parts that are sticking out that were previously treated as intakes, we're going to now make those retro thrusters. Oh. So we'll be using that to help stop the ship. And the intakes will now be on the bottom and on the top. So the LN has this gigantic intake sort of sitting on the back in addition to these gigantic intakes on the side. So now every version of the Aurora will have a small intake sitting on the back and the LN will just have a bigger one of those and bigger retro thrusters on the sides.
Gotcha. Dealing with an elite here, Aburn. Ben, I bet you can guess that there's a couple questions about the Banu Merchantman. I don't even have to read them. You know what the questions about the Banu Merchantman are?
No, yes, they are. They're doing some additional concepting work on the interior right now. I believe we published one of the recent concept images in the newsletter sneak peek.
Yes.
2 or 3 weeks ago. So it is not getting modeled in the game right now, but we are at the step right before that.
Yes, guys. If you don't check out the weekly newsletter, why not? There have been a number of impressive sneak peeks recently, but that Banu Merchantman, even I was surprised at that. That was very cool.
Yeah, I think that was the one people were most excited about.
Yeah, and that's Emmanuel Shui. How do you say it? Emmanuel Shui?
Shu?
Emmanuel Shu? He's back. He's the one, the same artist that concepted the exterior. He's back doing the interior.
Yes, and they're doing out of the UK, so nice. We don't get to see it as much as we'd like to, but it is. It's really exciting that some of these ships are coming together.
Right. Now, we have gotten some questions here about one of your answers from Quantum Questions earlier this week, specifically about what the next concept sale was. A couple people are singing the DuckTales lyrics in chat here.
Yeah, it wasn't exactly subtle, I guess, for anyone our age.
Gotcha. But do you want to go officially on the record with what the next concept ship?
The next one you're going to see anyway is the Hurricane, and I can say nothing more about it yet. I will say we've been working hard. I say we, but I mean other people have been working really hard
the
on
royal
it.
We. The royal
yes,
we.
Yes, the UK ship team we, who are just amazing, talented people. But I think just yesterday we got back some of the images that we're going to use in the brochure, and it's looking cool.
Can we give a shout out to the artists working on that?
Absolutely.
Yeah. So that's actually Justin Wentz, who's doing the concept art for the Hurricane, and he actually sits right behind me, so I get to turn around and see what he's doing on a daily basis, and it is looking really nice.
Yeah. We got a fun idea for the booklet, and it's going to be a good one. But we have any number of ships. I think there's 5 that are in different stages of concept right now. So there's going to be more stuff to see later in the year.
Hey, Gamble, earlier when we were getting set up, you said that you had some questions from Vinny, or for Vinny, rather.
I actually do. I kind of asked my my subscribers to come up with a couple of questions as well. And we cooked up with a couple of interesting ones. First one was actually submitted by Dexor, and he asks, and this one is pretty good. Does QA sometimes have valuable inputs which have led to design or modeling changes when they, for instance, notice something could work better in actual gameplay, or is their role solely on assuring the quality?
Well, actually, we have a pretty integrated work environment to where, you know, we're working alongside with developers and designers as they're coming up with the system. So there's plenty of times when somebody will be working on something new and they'll call us over and say, hey, can you check this out? Is this intuitive? Does this seem like it's cool? And, you know, we're able to give our input, you know, just right there, you know, while they're working on it. And, you know, sometimes even, you know, just see them make changes at the same time. They're like, okay, well, what if I changed it to this? Can you try it now? And so, you know, we're actually, you know, we're in the trenches with them, which is, you know, a great thing for us, you know, particularly coming from, you know, I worked in publisher QA where that was, you know, there was a big wall between developers and QA, and you're pretty much just there to generate bug reports. We're actually, you know, we're right there with them, and it's kind of rewarding to actually be able to see, hey, I did that. I told them to do that, you know, certain situation.
That's one of the fantastic things about Star Citizen in general is there's this respect for everybody's thoughts. I mean, I'll watch Skype and I'll see like Toast having suggestions for things, and you know, there's not another game company in the world where your lawyer both yeah, cares right. And has good ideas.
Yeah, exactly.
But I'm willing to bet there's not another game company in the world that has a lawyer like Toast, though.
Yeah, there's only one Toast.
There's only one Toast.
I mean, I mean, you've worked at multiple studios in your career.
Oh yeah.
And you worked on a lot of projects. I've been looking into your profiles. Mm-hmm. what is the biggest change, biggest change actually working for a project like Star Citizen with CIG compared to those other studios?
Well, I mean, we kind of already hit on it because, like I said, I was publisher side QA. So there's kind of like this wall between publisher QA and then the internal dev QA. And you're pretty much just checking stuff for, you know, making sure things, you know, could go to code, you know, and pass submission for Xbox and, you know, Sony and stuff like that. So, I mean, it is totally different to be there, you know, like I said, in the trenches the whole time. Being able to just walk up to people and talk to them. As opposed to, oh, well, I got to send an email to a producer, and then the producer sends the email to the actual developer's producer, and then eventually, you know, 3 months later, right. You may or may not get a response. You know, I actually kind of have a bad reputation here because I will just walk up to any developer, no matter what they're talking about, and, you know, I'll just interrupt and say, hey, what's going on with this thing? What's going on with that? So, you know, I just like getting my nose in other people's business sometimes when it comes to what they're working on, because, you know, I know I'm going to have to look at it in a little bit. And I'd rather get ahead of the game when it comes to certain things as opposed to waiting for it till it's dropped in my lap.
Right. Okay. And there was another question. This one was submitted by Whitesnake. He has always been curious if there is a lot of specialization in the QA department in a way that that there's one or two people who are the ship testers, and then there are some who prefer to do weapons or server testing or... You know, is there actually, like, do you put people, because you're actually a lead, so you have probably have a say in that, do you put people on specific projects, or are they able to, like, get their own voice into that as well?
Well, pretty much everybody touches everything, but we do, we're really big proponents of a specialist system where, you know, you find a niche, something that you like. You know, like, I came to this company for spaceships, you know, and I was 5 years old, dreamed of flying an X-Wing, and so, you know, I was like, this is what I wanted to do, and I wanted to be able to be, you know, work with the spaceships. So that's kind of what I became my focus when I first started here. Other people, you know, they have different interests. You know, the first-person shooter aspect. So it's like, oh, hey, you really like FPSs. Well, you know, you can become one of our Star Marine guys. You know, other people have expertise when it comes, you know, like server creation, you know, monitoring bandwidth and all that other types of different stuff, you know, helping with the net code. So we really encourage testers to, you know, find something that they like, find something that they're interested in and working with, and, you know, the developers that they have fun working with. And, you know, take it and run with it. You know, it's like I became, you know, right now I'm working primarily on item 2.0, which is really cool because, you know, I get to bother Mark Gabent and, you know, collect his tears, as we like to say in the QA, whenever his code doesn't quite work the way it's supposed to be. But yeah, no, it's a lot of fun, and we definitely encourage specialization. So, you know, there are people who are, you know, focusing on Squadron 42, some people on Star Marine, other people on ship combat, other people on the persistent universe, and it works out really well because that way you have an authority in every single studio, who not only the QA team knows to go to, but the devs do too. So, you know, if a dev gets a Squadron 42 bug and they haven't been through, you know, what's going on, then, you know, they're going to need a little help to how to get to the area where they need to reproduce the bug. So.
Hey, right.
Is there team damage in Pirate Storm?
I believe so.
Yes, there is.
Then I owe you an apology, Vinny.
Was that you that killed me? Because I know I died, and I didn't think I would die on wave 8, because yeah, I usually don't when I'm by myself.
I was sitting here chasing a guy. I'm like, why don't I have a target lock on this guy? I'm just going to shoot him. And I realized it was my teammate. That's why there was no target lock on him.
Well, at least you didn't get kicked.
Yeah. We have a question for Ben. With these new models... a question that comes up quite a bit, and it's in the chat right now. Will folks ever be able to buy the old models? You know, some folks like the, you know, maybe even prefer the old versions of ships.
Not with the current updates. So it's a one-for-one replacement for the ones we're working on now, the Cutlass, the Aurora, the Constellation. In the future, we absolutely want to have ships that age. So, you know, there would be the 2948, 2949, 2950 Aurora over time. So we're kind of looking ahead to that. But right now, the idea of updating ships isn't just, oh, it's cool to do this. It's totally essential to where we're going with the game. So the old ship just would no longer be functional.
Yeah.
So yeah.
As we update ship systems and the way that we build the ships and.
Like, yeah, I mean, excuse me. It comes down to just sort of like a. Partially a gameplay reason. Components need to be supported, or ship items need to be supported on these ships, and not all of the old ones do, which is part of the reason why we have to update it. And then damage is a big part of it, right? So the way we do our damage is completely different than the way the old models were. And at a certain point, you kind of have to just cut off the way we used to do it and bring everything in line.
I think the one exception is the Constellation, which in the fiction, there is a Mark III Constellation that's the old design, but we don't actually have it in the game. And one of the, a lot of people see this, they're like, oh, why are you throwing out this work? You know, but that's not actually how it works. You just normally don't see all the iterations a model or a system goes through in game development. So this is a completely normal practice in that regard.
Elwin, you guys just recently finished up work on the Caterpillar.
That we did, yeah.
What was that like?
Man, that was a long time.
Yeah, you were on the Caterpillar for a long, while.
Yeah, it was many months. It was me, Daniel, and Jin, and also Justin, who's concepting the Hurricane now. He was helping us out with fleshing that out. He actually did quite a bit of work on that. Yeah, it was many months of just hunkering down on this one massive asset and seeing progress very, very, very slowly until finally it just came to fruition and it all sort of came together at the last minute.
It's such a cool looking ship, though, and I am so happy that you guys did such a good job and that you did it all, because if I look back through my email, I must have hundreds and hundreds of where's the Caterpillar from back then.
We're happy to have put it out and that people like it. Obviously, when I look at it, I wish I had more time. That's always the way I feel at the end of each one of these pieces, is I just wish I had more time to polish it even further, because there are plenty of things I would go in there and improve. But I'm just really happy that as you walk through that ship, it really does feel like the original intent when we first started production.
Totally,
right?
Totally.
It really does feel claustrophobic. It does feel dank. It feels dangerous. And those doors, man, that's like one of my favorite things. I love that they can all open and that people actually can fly Merlins through. That's pretty hilarious.
I saw so many different pitches for what to do with those over the years, and you guys totally nailed it.
Cool. Well, I'm glad you guys like it.
Oh, and not only do we like it, Jim Martin, the original concept artist for the Caterpillar, he was actually in the office yesterday, and we were showing it to him, and he's thrilled. He's thrilled with the work that you've done for it.
And to the fantastic backers who sent us the 3D models, he got one. So.
Oh yeah, I have it sitting right on top of my monitor. Thank you.
Yeah, but for Star Citizen Deadweight and his son who made the large Caterpillar model, he also made quite a few smaller models, one for every member of the ship team. We gave one for Elwin and one to Justin, I think, and we gave the last one to Jim Martin yesterday. So.
Nice.
So, Deadweight, if you're watching, mission accomplished. So, hey, Ben.
Yes.
Carrick?
Oh, Carrick. Yes, tell us all about it.
No update right now, sorry.
Yeah.
We know you guys want it.
Yeah, this the work must be done on that ship.
Yeah. Just a matter of getting to the point where we do it. It's up ahead.
I'm not doing so well.
There's a lot of stuff on the ship side that's currently in motion.
Yeah.
A surprisingly huge amount of stuff.
Yeah, the Buccaneer is looking really cool. The Cutlass update, you guys are doing just amazing work with that.
I guess Drake is getting quite a bit of work done, but there's other ships, and obviously I'm not sure what we can and can't talk about, but just like knowing what people are working on, it's like, that's a huge amount of stuff being worked on right now.
Yeah, I know that. I know there's one we definitely can't talk about, but it's...
Yes, you heard it here first. There's definitely one we can't talk about. Let's see. There's a question about an Aurora Mark II. I don't remember any talk about an Aurora Mark II. That doesn't sound familiar to me. Do you remember anything about an Aurora Mark II?
Don't recall that one.
Yeah, that's probably more a community rumor. That's probably.
I mean, it sounds like it might be one of those conversations where it's like, oh, you know, maybe in the future we'll make a sort of updated version, which is a different hull.
Well, the Aurora LN was the 2944 Aurora, right? It was the next year Aurora when it was originally revealed, right?
Yes, that's right.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. I did not even make it to Wave 11, guys. Are you already out? Yes. I did not equip myself very well. I not only shot my teammates, but I flew right into it was a Super Hornet.
It's a poor workman who blames his tools, Jared.
No, I'm not blaming the tools. I'm telling you what I did. That just lets me focus on questions here. So let's see. What control method is the QA lead currently using? Well, you are using a Cytec HOTAS.
Yep.
It looks like the X-56, if I'm not correct.
Yeah, the X-56, I like it because it's got the thumb analog, so you can bind strafe to it and, you know, not have to worry about that.
Yes.
It's worth it just for the cool blue glow.
That, too.
Can I
shiny.
Ask you a question, Vince?
What's up?
That's not how this works.
I'm sorry. I just can't. I have to ask. Because I notice you're using the lag indicator as opposed to the lead indicator.
Hmm.
I cannot, no matter how hard I try, I cannot fly ships and shoot with the lag indicator. Were you able to just immediately start using that successfully, or did it take a while to get used to for you?
No, it seemed pretty obvious to me.
Because I'm just watching him destroy fools using that, and I'm like, I can't even...
Well, that's because that's, you know, one's telling you where you're going, the other one's telling you where you're shooting, so...
Vinny Sinatra, folks.
What's up?
I said Vinny Sinatra, folks.
That's right. I'm succinct. Concise. That's why they like my bugs.
Jared, would you like an excuse to explain your outfit?
Oh, I totally forgot. I totally forgot. There haven't been any questions. There haven't been many questions at all. People just assume I'm doing something weird, which is nice. No, this is my. We went to PAX South. Went to PAX South this last weekend, and on the final day of PAX South, I went to the historic market district down in San Antonio, looking for an authentic souvenir, and instead, this is what I ended up with. This is my serape.
A poncho?
The serape. Ponchos are closed on the sides. This is open on the sides.
Chad already called it a poncho.
Well.
No shame in wearing a poncho, Jared.
Now, if I'm wearing a poncho, I look like the guy in Unforgiven. No, not Unforgiven. Unbreakable. Every time I think of a poncho with a baseball cap, I always think of Bruce Willis in that movie. Because apparently he had some aversion to water. I don't remember.
Well, I'm sorry. This went nowhere.
Yep. Hey, Ben. Any updates on the Cartuwall? Cartuwall's in-game?
Yep. Yeah, flyable right now.
Yeah. You can fly the Cartuwall right now.
I think Gamble's carrying us here.
Any progress on...
Oh, somebody has to do it.
Yeah. Any progress on making the P-52 Merlin deployable from the Constellation? It's definitely something we want to do. I mean,
yeah, that is actually more of a question for the dev side.
I mean, so I went ahead when we were first finishing up the Constellation some time ago. I was helping out with the actual docking mechanism where the Merlin actually connects to it. So that whole thing is already built on the art side and animates to support it. But we need developer help to actually make that tech working. Actually, it's related to the same technology that's necessary in order to get the Caterpillar command module to detach as well. So those two things require the same work.
Let's see. The Redeemer. I haven't had a question about the Redeemer in quite some time.
Redeemer. We have so many. Redeemer is the TNGS ship, right?
Yes.
Yeah, it says, when will we see it in hangar? The Redeemer is viewable in hangar right now.
Yeah, the current version is in hangar. It needs a real overhaul before it's flyable and totally ready for action, but that's coming.
Yep. Let's see what else we got. Delta patcher status. Yes, Delta patching is super, super awesome and necessary. We want it just as bad as you guys do, trust me. No updates on the win, though. Let's see what else we got here. Yep. Let's see, people are asking about my poor fashion choices, but people don't want to know about that, but that's the questions we're getting, so I'm not going to answer it. Any progress on other ships like the Prospector? What are we building right now? What's actually being worked on right now? It's being built. Let's just go.
But that's our problem. There's a bunch we aren't allowed to talk about right now.
Well, we've talked about the Buccaneer.
Mm-hmm. Oh. Yep.
And the Cutlass.
Yep.
And the Aurora.
Yep. And there are some really big ones in the UK undergoing production. Again, I don't know whether I can mention them or not, but those are larger teams.
Yes.
Right? I do know of a very small ship that's currently in production, but I don't know if it's been mentioned yet.
I think that's one of the ones we're not supposed to talk about.
Okay. All right.
Well. But it's really cool.
Yeah, people keep asking about a Cartuwall update. There's no update to the Cartuwall in progress.
No, that ship is ready to go.
That ship is, it's in the game.
It's combat ready.
So. Please mention. All right. Let's see. Any work on the Freelancer variants? Any updates on Freelancer variants? Are those on the schedule for this year?
They're certainly on the schedule. They're not being worked on right now.
Gotcha.
Everything is scheduled out, all these updates and concept ships. They've got a really good pipeline going.
Let's see. What else we got here? With the flight model changes and the Cutlass rework underway, can the handling of the Cutlass in 2.6 be taken as indicative of how she will handle once the rework is complete? I think ship handling is constantly being evaluated and reevaluated and reevaluated.
Yeah.
So what it is right now is only indicative of what it is right now.
Yeah, from our perspective, it can change every day with a new build. It's.
And of course, you remember as you know, you're doing a lot of work on the item 2.0 system. Mm-hmm. As more ship component systems come online, you will be able to affect the handling of a ship. So you know, the handling of any ship right now is of only the stock components. Mm-hmm. Well, as item 2.0 progresses, as the ship component system comes online, and more things like the coolers and the avionics and all that stuff comes online, you will be able to directly affect the way a ship handles. So. Let's see. What else do we got here? How is Spectrum deployment coming? Any updates on Spectrum? Still working on it. It's in testing right now on the PTU. Everybody has access to it on the PTU right now. If you haven't had a chance to test Spectrum, you can go to ptu.cloudimperiumgames.com. I believe that's the URL.
Yeah, they're just patching that constantly. They're making all sorts of changes. Mm-hmm. We're getting close.
Yep. So the more people in there testing, the better. So if you want to help out, you can go sign up on the PTU website right now. Let's see. Will there be weather in 3.0? Well, that question was answered in yesterday's Around the Verse. If you haven't watched yesterday's Around the Verse, you'll see lots of different weather systems being worked on for our procedural planet system. So check it out. There was snow. And some desert wind, and there was quite a lot of flora, being affected by the environment and stuff. It was pretty cool. They're doing some great work. Tyler was very fond of the snow. Let's see.
No way.
Let's see.
Have we mentioned that Tyler is... He would be here, but he's not feeling too well.
Yeah, we mentioned at the beginning of the show.
Okay.
Yeah.
I miss him so much.
Well, get well soon, Tyler. I assume you're watching this.
I miss him, guys.
Thanks, JJ. JJ on the keyboards, everybody.
Hey, everyone.
Let's see. Will CIG be at Gamescom this year?
I am not sure if we have announced our plans for this year yet.
We have not announced our plans for this year yet.
So we can't do it right now. I'm sorry. But stay tuned.
Let's see. What else we got? Good to hear the starter ship Aurora getting up to standard. But how about the equally important Mustang?
Oh, that's a good question. So, yeah, the Mustang is also going to be getting updated. The Mustang poses a few special challenges. because there was a lot of work that way. We actually, when we first built that ship, we built it and all the variants at once with three different artists working in two different studios. And so there's a lot that went into building that ship that's completely different than the way we do our ships now. So it poses a bit of a challenge into how we tackle doing variants now the way, to bring it in line with the way we currently do variants. So we will be redoing it, but that won't be for a little while yet, actually.
But we went ahead and gathered a whole mess of feedback on the Mustang. So.
Good. So we'll know exactly what people want fixed.
Mm-hmm.
One bug in particular, I think.
Yes. There's definitely Which one's one that? Bug in particular.
All right. Let me do something here real quick. So one of you will have to take the reins here.
Oh, all right.
Nope. That was bad.
So you guys have any exciting weekend plans?
Well, I'll be moving. I don't know if that's super exciting.
What's congratulations worthy?
Oh, well, I mean, so I... It sounds like a bigger move than it actually is. I'm just moving to a larger space because I'm bringing in all of my wife's stuff. So we need a little bit more space in order to keep things together.
Cool.
Yep.
I'm not doing this
one. What about you, Sergeant?
Well, I don't enjoy weekends anymore because I went and got my girl pregnant, so...
Well, that gets a congratulations, too.
I guess so, yeah. So, yeah, exciting times. So, no, I'm not actually... I don't plan a lot in the weekend except for work, if I have to work in the weekends. And other than that, I spent my time on streaming and taking care of my girlfriend, I guess, right. A little bit.
How is Vidal Swarm going? I can't quite see it from here.
We are on wave 15.
Nice.
I'm on my last life, though, thanks to Jared.
Let me think. So speaking of the Aurora, if you're a subscriber, we're going to have a couple images from the gray boxing phase up in the vault later today. what other housekeeping do we have? Watch for the Star Citizen newsletter today. There's some exciting news about 261 in there that I think people will appreciate.
I had a life back, then I had to do a note, so.
You like how you sandbagged for about six, seven waves.
Well, I forgot that I was looking, I was trying to find the questions, and I forgot that you get lives. But one of the questions is, will there be a 262? Yeah, yes, we mentioned a 262 in the weekly newsletter last week. It was last week or the week before? I can't remember. 262 is Chris mentioned the 262 patch in the forward for our weekly newsletter. With our intention of introducing the Mega Map feature.
Oh, I know another one we should mention. Monthly report. It is not gone. It will be published next week. We've just collected all the reports from the studios yesterday, and we've got to put them together and fancy them up, and so you'll have a monthly report in a couple of days.
So let's see what else we got here. Talk about new salvage ships for 30 seconds. Are there any new salvage ships?
None that we can talk about. I'm sorry.
Yep. Have you seen the season 2 pilot of The Expanse yet? No, I have not seen season 2 of The Expanse yet.
I actually do have a mining question for Ben.
I don't know that I can answer that, but I'll give it a shot.
I can try. It's like relating to mining infrastructure, more or less. This was submitted by Gua here. Can some of the tasks be broken up further? Like, for example, a few 325As could use its sensors sweep and launch prospecting missiles. Find a set of good asteroids, transfer their data to a herald who goes off to sell the data while the 325As continuing a discovery. Could that be a thing?
Well, with specifically in terms of mining, totally a Tony Z question. So we'll have to wait for next time he's on. In general, yes, you will see a lot more specialized utilities for ships as we get item system 2.0 and kind of more distinct options for people in terms of, you know, scanners and add-ons and mods and such. We started with weapons and, you know, guns and missiles, and now we're expanding to other stuff. In general, yes, but as for the specifics of how mining will work, that's totally a PU design question.
Okay. Well, thank you, either way. Is Jared actually helping us here?
Yes, he's
not helping us.
He's doing something. I don't know if I would consider it flying or fighting, but he's definitely doing something.
Let's see. Yeah. For questions, I see a lot of questions about 3.0 and stuff like that. For questions about the future and what's coming and stuff, up and stuff, you really want to tune into things like Around the Verse. That's where most of our, you know, future development update stuff is going to come from, guys.
And also check back later today for the updated production report for 261 scheduling. Will be up on the website. If it's not right now, it will be shortly.
This M50 is tricky.
They're fast.
They're somewhat of a pain.
Well, the AI got a big bump with 2.6. I used to be. I won't insult everybody and say I was good. but I was better.
I've never seen you be good.
They actually do things like use missiles and afterburner now, which really helps.
Let's see.
Apparently they shot off my
engines. Here's a question for you, Vinny. What's the most fun or memorable bug you've seen on a ship?
One of my favorites is definitely during CitizenCon, the homestead. We had a lot of problems hitting the rover in the Connie, and there was one where it basically, you know, looked like the Connie was giving birth to it, and it was a troubled pregnancy. Obviously, that one got a few laughs. What else? I mean, a lot of them are just annoying, such as the aforementioned Mustang bug that we always refer to. You know, we definitely want to see a lot of those get fixed eventually. But, you know, we've definitely had some funny ones. Anything with IK is always hilarious because, you know, you get guys with the twisted limbs trying to get into their seats.
You should tell people what IK is.
Oh, I don't even know what it stands for. That's what
Inverse
I was trying to avoid.
Kinematics.
That, what he said.
So
yes.
Essentially what it does is it will figure out the best solution for moving sort of a joint. So you'll give it a target, and then it'll figure out how to rotate the two different bones in order to give you a sensible-looking motion.
Why do you know that?
Well, it's an animation thing.
All right. I'll see some of the people in chat had the answers.
I just don't want to mark
job,
it
guys.
In bug notes. That's IK.
So, Elwin, how long is the timeline from concept to gray box on chips now? Obviously, that's going to change a lot based on the size of the ship.
Concept to gray box. So I'm going to assume until we're done with gray box. Is that?
Yeah, the space between concept and gray box. That's a scheduling thing. But when you get started, when it comes time to like, okay, it's time to start building the ship.
Mm-hmm.
What's your timeline on that now?
So it really depends exactly as what you said, the size of the ship. To give you an example, the Caterpillar, we spent about a month, maybe a month and a half, getting one of the rooms from concept to final, basically finished. But on the bigger ships, what we tend to do is we tend to build hero rooms first, and then we'll move on to building all of the rest of the rooms using pieces from what we've already built, because it'll make production faster and faster and faster. So every new room you build goes faster than the previous room. So we got to the point on some spaces in the Caterpillar that we would get them done in like 3 or 4 days. But that was after a long time of building out a kit. Smaller ships like the Aurora or the Buccaneer or whatnot, it typically takes about, I would say about 2 months to get to the point where you're basically done with gray box. And from that out, you're finalizing all of your materials and textures and palms, and then you start doing all of your damage work and everything that's required for the game to actually use it as a ship in the game. So proxies for collision, shields, all that stuff.
And it's totally amazing, at least from my perspective, watching a ship like the Buccaneer come together so quickly compared to what it took in 2013 to get some of the first ships online. The process they have is just so streamlined and...
Yeah, it's gotten a lot better. Much, much faster. We really did get the Buccaneer up and running. Essentially, I mean, from nothing to gray box, I think it was about a month and a half.
And for some of the even smaller ones, it seems like instant. I had that experience with the Dragonfly. It was like, oh, and it works now. So
yeah. Well, I mean, those smaller ships is, you know, it's a lot less work. So the real tiny ones can get done much faster. But it's a little deceiving because there is a point at which it doesn't matter how much smaller you go, it's still going to cost you. Like getting smaller than a Dragonfly, for example, is probably not going to save you much time because you still need to set it up for animation and all the interactables and all that stuff. And that will all still take the same amount of time.
So don't look for a space Segway or a space surfboard anytime soon.
What you got, Sergeant Gamble? I know you got more questions.
My questions are out as well.
All right, let's see. What are we looking at here? Well, we're almost at time anyway. Let's see if we can squeeze a few more in before we take off here. Wedding questions are always going to be the tougher ones, guys. I don't know if you remember the old RTV days, but wedding questions are always the answer to wedding questions are almost always universally, you know, when it's ready.
Yeah, when we actually have a when that we can share, we shout it at the rooftops. The
yes,
minute,
we do.
Because we want you to know when.
Yeah. So when you sit, so unfortunately, when questions are almost universally the hardest ones to do. Let's see. Somebody keeps asking which ships will be able to hold the Firefly, and there's no Firefly in our game, so.
You probably mean the Dragonfly.
Ah.
And that is a TBD, largely. For the larger ships, we think about it, but we don't promise it. Best way to put it. But they fit in the Caterpillar.
They do. They definitely do. In fact, the very front of the Caterpillar was designed to make sure you can hold at least two of those facing forward. Now, whether game design decides that that's one too many, that's up to them to decide for balance reasons, but it can hold up to two, and if you really want, probably three.
Keep cramming them in there.
Yeah.
We've already seen videos of people cramming Merlins in every single bay of the Caterpillar and whatnot. It's there's always, you know, our intention, and then there's what you guys will do with it.
Honestly, I was really surprised to see that with the Merlin, because the Merlin is pretty long. For a small ship, it's a pretty long ship, and I did not expect people to get that thing in there at all.
Yeah.
Man, I think everybody was surprised with that one video where they had the Merlins on the open doors, and it went to quantum, and
it wasn't
supposed to work that way.
Yeah, that was awesome.
Somebody asked what the Vandal ship they saw at the end of ATV yesterday was. That was the Vandal Driller. And there is actually a whole video dedicated to that on our YouTube channel. You can check that out on our YouTube channel. But that was the Vandal Driller, which we first showcased towards the end of last year.
Yeah, we tend not to share as much of the Vandal ships just because they're going to be such a big part of Squadron, but they're really cool.
Yep. Wave 18 is our last wave, right?
Yes.
Yes. All right.
You can do this. By which I mean Sergeant Gamble can do this, and Vinny can do this,
yes.
And Jared cannot.
Once again, I died right at the edge of wave 18. All right. Let's see what else we got.
Oh, that's a lot of missiles.
Maybe this might be one for Elwin. Any thoughts on the intricacies of landing and takeoff? For example, the landing gear and engine noise volume. You don't work on the sound or volume, really.
I don't work on the sound or volume at all. But I will say that when I'm working, I typically, especially when I'm doing animations, I'm typically hearing sounds in my mind for how they might, you know, actually sound as it plays, and that sort of helps me add a little bit more character to the movements. I guess that honestly, I don't want to speak for the sound team, but that probably really depends on a couple of things. One, how big a ship is, obviously. Two, what corporation? Because I'm assuming that different corporations have different build qualities.
Yep.
So the sound of a landing gear on a Caterpillar would be very different than the sound of a landing gear on a Origin ship, for example.
Yeah, I can imagine Origin tries to have it as quiet as possible. It's a civilian ship, and whereas Anvil will be like, you know, ship on an aircraft, you know, on an aircraft carrier, you better wear headphones.
Right, exactly.
Now, the Caterpillar has a number of landing gear.
Oh, a number. just a few, I'd say.
How many does it have, actually? I don't know the answer to that one.
It's got, I believe it's 12.
12 landing gears.
12 landing gears, yeah.
Is that like the legs of a Caterpillar.
Yeah, exactly.
We totally meant to do that the whole time.
It's all you, Gamble. Your only hope.
What?
Oh, my God. Really?
Help us, Sergeant Gamble. Is there a...
Let's check the scoreboard there. Look at Disco Lando. That was awesome.
Yeah, well, I... Yeah. My ping's better than yours.
Your ping was better than mine.
I won ping.
Ooh.
All right.
Now we're all just totally compelled by citizen.
That's right. We're almost at the end here anyway. So let's get at least two more questions in before we tie this up here. Let's see what's going on here. Just looking. I'm looking for a good one. We're getting questions like, can you land a reclaimer? We find out when we rebuild it and stuff. Let's see. What else we got here?
Idris and hangers. We did that the other day. It didn't end up well.
Yeah. Hey, does the command module have hard points, Elwin, in the Caterpillar?
Yes, it does, actually. It's got 3 hard points, 1 on the top and 2 on either side.
I do. And is the intention for those to still function when it separates? You'll be able to shoot
on the command module? Yeah. Oh, they absolutely must. Okay. Yeah, they have to. How else are you supposed to shoot at the guy, at the bad guys when you're trying to escape?
Okay. Let's see. What else we got here? Status of the HUD rework. The UI team is constantly working on the UI and stuff. So I think the status is just constantly in development. Unless you know something.
It's insane. It's literally constantly in development. Yeah. It works like 23.5 hours a day.
Yeah. No, he really does.
That guy's a soldier.
All right. So we didn't quite beat Vandal Swarm. We came close. We got to wave 18 though. Not a bad job. Not a bad job, guys.
No, you're all failures. Let's not sugarcoat this.
I think Vince and I got to wave 18.
Yeah, no.
I mean, you should all be as disappointed in yourself as I am.
You set out from like wave 6 to wave 14 or something like that.
Yep.
I'm sick.
And then died first.
And then died right after he got back in.
Yes. All right, guys. Well, with that, I think that wraps up this episode of Happy Hour, guys. Thanks for joining us in this episode. Thank you again to Vinny Sinatra for subbing in for Community Manager Tyler Wicken from the Austin office. Thank you, Elwin, for taking a little time out of your day for talking about the Aurora. So let's go ahead and show the Aurora one more time there, since I had that building. Let's show the Aurora.
It's a beautiful Aurora.
Yep. Again.
Here it is.
Your Aurora. This gray box Aurora. Now, this is only gray box. It's only going to look even better from here.
That's the goal. Yeah.
That's the goal. I have absolutely no doubt, having seen your work on other ships. So
I appreciate it. Thank you.
And Ben, thank you for swinging by. It's nice to have you on the show again.
I appreciate you having me on. It's
it's weird seeing this far away from you.
Yes. They can't see this, can they?
They can't see this. We're quite far away. All right, guys.
Don't forget to thank
Gamble. And Sergeant Gamble, I understand you're gonna keep streaming for right after the show here.
Yes, for sure.
Why don't we give you a Star Citizen and Squadron 42 combo package with an Aurora to give away? Let's make it the Aurora LN. Make the Aurora LN so you get the top of the line Aurora, so you can give that away in your stream. And
awesome.
So with that, I'm Jared. That's Vinny. That's Elwin. That's Ben. We'll see you next week, guys.